Hello, welcome to the Banker's monthly preview of the May cover story. I'm Joy Macknight, editor of The Banker, and with me in the studio is Anita Hawser, who's Europe editor at The Banker, who wrote the cover story, which is all about the evolving definition of what is a bank. Anita, thanks so much for joining me.
That's okay.
I guess the big question is that you just think that the definition of a bank would be really relatively straightforward in terms of the boundaries of the bank, but obviously that's changing. What do you think is the common definition of a bank?
I imagine that most people would think of a deposit-taking institution. They may say like a trusted store of value or trusted intermediary. Then if you spoke to a Gen Z or millennial, they may say it's an app that helps them manage their finances better. Everybody I spoke to, there was no single definition. But I think a lot of the banks spoke a lot about trust. Mm. So I think they feel that is what distinguishes them from a lot of the new entrants that are offering services that banks used to, you know, still do offer. But now you have other entrants, fintechs, tech companies, e-money institutions that are doing lending, they're doing payments, they're offering you accounts. So I don't think a single definition suffices anymore.
Okay. And so how is the purpose and function of a bank evolving?
I think it's more the customers that are driving this. Mm. I think banks are still doing what they've always done. They're still offering lending. They're still offering accounts. But in order to compete in this sort of switched on digital world, the banks are trying to look more like tech companies rather than stuffy old banks. And that's not my words. That was actually somebody, a banker that I interviewed. And the tech companies are trying to look more like banks by embedding financial services, be it Apple Pay, be it Uber, be it buy now, pay later. So I think there's sort of this blurring of the lines because of the way that, you know, banking is evolving. It's more mobile. Younger people may not even have their first bank account with a traditional bank. It may be an app that's layered over the top of a number of bank accounts that enables them to manage their finances better. I think also regulation, of course, is playing a part. It's opened up banking, literally, open banking and APIs. So it can look and feel a bit different. And also you have regulation giving rise to these new entrants, such as e-money institutions, which are picking off bits of the value chain traditionally offered by banks and trying to offer that in a more sort of user-friendly, slick sort of customer experience.
Excellent. And I guess the big question is, why does this matter?
It matters because I think people are confused. I think if you went out on the street today and asked a wide variety of people, what is a bank, or do they think that Revolut is a bank? A lot of people would probably say yes. So I think we have this blurring of lines between banks and non-banks. And I think for certain generations, this traditional definition of what is a bank doesn't hold true. Mm. But why does this matter? Because you're not as protected. If you're moving money or holding money with a non-bank, there's just not the same levels of protection. You don't have a deposit guarantee scheme, for example. And even e-money institutions, they're meant to hold your money in a segregated account with a third party or a bank. That doesn't necessarily mean that that money is safe either. What if something happens to that bank? And we've seen recently with the banking crisis, a run on banks. So it matters when something goes wrong and companies fall over and then people just are not sure how are they protected.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for your insights, Anita. So you can read Anita's cover story on what is a bank in the May issue of The Banker and also on thebanker.com, along with multitudes of more news analysis pieces, videos and podcasts.